Have you read this book, Goodbye Things by Fumio Sasaki? He's got, I think there's 55 steps on how to declutter and things to do. It just gives you some ideas, and I think it's worthwhile if you're considering trying to get your home organized. You don't have to be a minimalist to enjoy this book and get great ideas from it. I think the only time I was truly a minimalist or even closest to the Scandinavian Nordic style is when I was first living on my own, because I had nothing. It was super simple, minimalist, easy to clean, no clutter. I kind of wish I could go back to that now. So we have way more things than I ever thought we'd have, and the thought of clearing stuff out just puts dread into me. But this is so important to me, because not only is this minimalist Scandinavian design style so in, but it's also good for your health. One thing that I know is that if there is clutter around you, if you're living in chaos, and whether that's your life or the circumstances or the things around you, it causes incredible stress. My mother and her two sisters recently passed away from Alzheimer's, and I know what clutter did to my mom, and I saw over the years the accumulation of things that were all around her and how that chaos in her brain and the chaos in her home just all kind of grew together. I'm determined, not only for the aesthetics, but for mental health, to have a clutter-free home. So I'm going to get into the five things that you can do to help yourself, and five reasons why clutter and mess around you makes life really miserable. Number one, so disorganization causes stress. If you feel disorganized, chaotic, unable to keep up, guilty, those things are all things that cause stress. And when you have stress, it increases your cortisol levels, which is a bad hormone, and it causes inflammation in your body, including your brain. And when there's inflammation in your body, it breaks down your immunity and you can get sick and get diseases. So it's really important to decrease your stress. Decreasing stress can happen right in the home, and it can be simple as just the surroundings that you're in. So if it feels like clutter, it probably is clutter. Not only it's not doing anything for the home, it's not doing anything for your health. Okay, what is the first thing that you can start doing to declutter and start minimizing your things around you? You make a plan. Start off by listing the rooms that you want to organize and declutter. Even include things like your cabinets, your closets, your chests, whatever you've got, wherever you stuff things in, whatever drawer you have them. If you'd like to break it down to the tiniest of steps, include each drawer and cabinet. What you can do with that is put it on your calendar for the year. Outline your whole year in months and weeks, and then assign each week to each area. And that all depends on the time you have. If you work full time, how much spare time you have. It could be as small as starting off with one chest of drawers a week, or it could be one room in a week. It's all depending on you. But if you outline everything that you've put on your list of wanting to declutter for the whole calendar year, you'll be able to break it down. And it may seem like a long process at first, but when you start ticking off all those boxes that you've cleaned out this drawer, I've gotten rid of the stuff under my bed, I've cleaned out my bathroom drawer, I've cleaned out my closet. When you start doing those, you're gonna feel so excited, it's gonna make you feel so good, and it's gonna motivate you to go on to the next one. And before you know it, it'll be done. If you don't do this, it'll just be wishful thinking forever, but at least this way you're taking steps towards your goal. Number two, buying new things may cause guilt. Why do you want to buy something new to replace something that you already have that isn't broken and is still working fine? It's usually boredom, because our brain gets tired and bored of the same thing. It's looking for new stimulation. So that's why you go out and get that new thing, even though the other thing that you have is still just fine. Then what ends up happening is you start to have guilt because you bought something. Maybe you didn't need to buy it and you realize that. Have you heard of buyer's remorse? Maybe it was too expensive. Maybe it doesn't fit quite right. But now you've got two things. So now you've got the thing that you already have that was working fine, and you've got the new replacement. If you don't look after the old thing by either donating it or giving it away to somebody, now you've got even more guilt because you're sitting on something and procrastinating about doing something that you shouldn't have done in the first place. You should be giving away that item that you already had that's working fine, but you haven't gotten around to it. So the guilt builds on top of each other. You end up just having this brain mess because all you do is feel guilty about the things that you bought and when you had perfectly good items to begin with. And then what do I do with those old things? It's just a never-ending cycle. So what do you do to prevent that? You don't buy anything. That's exactly right. Don't buy it. Sleep on it. I would rather pay full price for something when I need it, when I absolutely need it, than when it's on sale. Because if I'm doing this correctly, even if I pay full price for something that I really need, I won't be doing that very often. And I won't be wasting money buying something just because I needed that little bit of stimulation and excitement. Definitely sleep on it, don't buy it. Number three, your things are always speaking to you. Yes, that is true. Have you ever wondered why you felt so much more relaxed when you went away somewhere? I personally feel like that if I've stayed in a hotel. Everything just seems more peaceful. That's because I don't have my things around me. When I sit at home, when I'm in my kitchen, I see my pantry that's a mess that I should, you know, clear out. I look in my fridge to get something and I thought, oh gosh, I gotta clean it out. There's stuff in here that's ancient, that's getting moldy. I gotta get it out of here. I look in our little office and I see the papers all over the desk. I look in my closet, I see clothes that I can't wear anymore and they're still in there. It just goes on and on and on. They're always talking to you. You see things that you've bought and you think, oh, I don't even like it anymore. I don't like the color. It was too expensive. I didn't really need it. This constant jibber jabber that your things are doing to you is causing you mental stress and it's making your home environment less soothing. All this information that just keeps coming into your brain, stimulation that your brain has to compute, it's constantly working. There's no downtime for it because you're constantly seeing this clutter. Your brain is telling you things and you're feeling guilty. It's an endless cycle. So what can you do about this endless chattering that's happening to you in your home? Well, throw a blanket over it and don't look at it. No, that won't work. What will happen is once you start your plan of decluttering and you've scheduled it out, eventually you're going to eliminate all that chatter from maybe one room at a time, and then eventually it'll be your whole home. And that's my goal because I need that. It's a work in progress and I'm working on it. And I hope you take this journey with me and we do this together. Your home will become a safe haven for you and it'll become a soothing place for you to relax, and you'll enjoy coming home once you started the decluttering process and you feel good about the things that you have in your home. Number four, is your home a museum for collections? You may be hanging on to things for nostalgic reasons, and that's another reason to think about the fact that if you lost something from that collection, if the collection went away, would you buy it back? Would you replace it? If not, then you probably don't need to have it around in your home. Because in reality, those collections are usually just dust collectors. They sit there basically because you don't have the heart to get rid of them. And you don't have to get rid of them in the garbage, but you can find a new home for them, somebody that wants them. And please don't re-gift things like that. Ask people if they're interested in them. If they say no, accept that. Do not push your collections onto somebody else, because then you're just causing the same situation for them. Truly, if you find that you have a lot of nostalgic collections, think about the fact that will they be in a better place and enjoyed more with somebody else, and then offer them to someone else. If it's something that truly would make you sad and you really want to replace, then keep it. Number five, it's so much harder to clean when you have a lot of things. I dread cleaning sometimes in an area where I have to keep moving stuff around. Plus, it always gets dirtier when there's a lot of things around. The best times and the times that I enjoyed cleaning the most was when I first moved out and I had hardly anything. It was a breeze. It was so easy to clean. Rooms full of nothing. It was perfect. Just whiz through there with a vacuum and you'd be done. So years ago, when I was just in the trenches with the kids and working full time, I was looking for something to help me, because working shift work like I did, the 12 hours, four on and four off, my days off would always change. So it was really hard to schedule kind of a regular like cleaning day for myself, like Wednesdays are cleaning days, because the days would always change. And then all my kids' schedules, well, I had to keep them on track, and my husband would help, of course. And I found the Fly Lady online. So I'm gonna put a link to everything I've described in the description box, so please check it out. So the Fly Lady's been around forever, and she's kind of I don't know, I'd call her retro style housekeeping information. Gosh, I think she was one of the first ones around that was very into home cleaning and things like that and had it online. So I followed her. She's got these plans. And one of the things she starts off with is you start off with baby steps, and she talks about shining your sink. Make sure the dishes are washed before you go to bed, and when you wake up in the morning, it's going to feel so good to find your kitchen clean to start the day off. So anyways, I'm going to put a link to Fly Lady. It'll give you some ideas of what she talks about. But boy, when you start getting rid of the clutter, it's so much easier to do your cleaning and keep things clean, and it will take less time and won't be such a thing that you just dread doing like I do. If you found any useful information in this video, hit the like button for me. I really would appreciate that. If you have any input on any of these ideas I suggested, leave me a comment. I love to read them. I'll be making more videos about cozy, healthy homes that are clutter-free and bring nature indoors like the Scandinavian style. I hope you have a great week. I'll see you in the next video. Bye!